came to visit plant friends. Cheers.
Hi.
Cheers, my love.
Mangrove YouTube show.
Plant friends, I'm so excited to introduce you to my fiance, if you haven't already met him, Billy Morrissey.
That is my name.
I said that weird.
You did? Said super weird.
Billy Morrissey, my fiance. Otherwise known as @Billy on Instagram, if you follow him or if you follow me.
I'm nowhere near as talented as she is on social media.
You make a pretty good reel.
It's just pictures of bread and me being stressed out.
Bread, beer, and pretty funny reels sometimes. But we're so excited to work together today to put together this video for you on 3 planty date ideas that we like to do ourselves and figured we'd share them with you. And we're making this in partnership with Allagash Brewing Company, my favorite brewery. They just released Fine Acre, their first year-round organic beer, which we will tell you about more at the end of the episode. So, Billy.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here.
Welcome to our home, where you live.
This is, I'm happy to be in the home that we live in. It's great.
I'm so happy to have you here. This is normally my area, so this is my planty writing, recording, interviewing, meditation, yoga nook. This is kind of my area of our loft, of our cabin.
There's a password to get in. I have to, like, knock on the wall. Can I come up?
There's a riddle, too.
The password is Monstera.
Exactly. See, he knows me so well. So I wanted to invite Billy up to the plant loft where we sometimes hang out for a beer and a little conversation on some planty date nights.
Yeah, this is my kind of social media, my kind of YouTube video. Mm-hmm. I'm very excited. I was literally just asked to come up and have a beer with the woman that I love and relax at the end of a work day, which is exactly my idea of like relaxing and just chilling for a bit.
You're the best. Billy.
Yes.
3 planty dates. Plant-inspired dates. Botanically inspired dates. I feel like our whole life is a botanically inspired date because we have 100 houseplants that we live with all the time.
Yes.
Especially when we were in 500 square feet in New York with 160 plants. We've got a little bit more of a better ratio now. But date number one.
Yes.
Which I think is probably the most exciting for you.
Okay.
Growing food together and then cooking that food together.
Yes. It's easily one of my favorite things. It's also like a real gesture of love, like cooking something for somebody. So I go to school at night. I'm really busy. She's really busy. We trade off who cooks dinner that night. And there's been a couple of really surprising and wonderful meals that, you know, you don't expect to be able to experience, but all of a sudden you come out after a long day and there's this like awesome little garden on a plate that's also delicious. So that's been really fun for us.
I make Billy gardens, edible gardens, and they're so fun. Billy is definitely the bigger, I'm a great cook, but Billy is a very passionate cook. So I feel like mostly I feel like you cook more than I do in our relationship. Mm-hmm. But like Billy said, I've been cooking for him a little bit more because he's in night school. And I have come up with also, okay, we live on 5 acres in the middle of the woods. We moved from New York City. There is no delivery here.
Truth.
So for the last 4 months while we've been living in the cabin, we have been cooking so much more because we don't even have the option of delivery. And in New York City, I would say we probably got delivery like 2 to 3 times a week.
Oh, easily.
So we've really been upping our cooking game. And the other thing is we both really miss Asian food in New York. There's just such a high quality Asian food in New York that we haven't been able to really find where we live. And so it's been really fun for me to start experimenting cooking different Asian recipes. And I found this amazing healthy version of chicken lettuce wraps from P.F. Chang's, which is unbelievable from Skinny Taste. And I've been making a side of a garden for Billy. Just, I don't know why, but my favorite thing to grow on the lettuce grow is violas. I think violas they're so beautiful. They're this edible flower. They're this beautiful purple hue. I sit and I drink my coffee in the morning and I just stare at them. Like, they're so happy.
They look like little purple hamster faces to me. Like, because they have, like, the little whiskers. I know it sounds weird. You've
never told me that
before. I've never told you that. But I always thought that they look like, and they're just like kind of like looking at you like, or like pugs.
Do that?
Or, you know, like, they're like all scrunched up and they got their little whiskers. I don't know. Maybe, like, I don't know. It's just something I always thought about and I've never said until right now and I'm not sure why I did, but whatever.
The man I love, everyone. Hamster, purple hamster faces.
I mean, maybe take that part out. I don't know.
Absolutely, we're not going to cut that out. 100% we're keeping that in the video. So anyway, violas make me happy. I will now grow them eternally in every garden we have. I'm pretty obsessed with them. So even though it's been fun to grow them, it's been kind of tricky to be like, what do we put these in? And that's where the idea of making a little garden for you came from. So if you want to make a meal together, or maybe one of you wants to make a meal for your partner, this is like a very simple recipe and it's super fun. So you grow viola, you grow what we grew for this meal that we're showing you. We have the spinach and kale that we grew and harvested. We have the viola and we have the butter crunch lettuce. So first off, you've got to prep your flowers for the garden. So there's two types of flowers that I have in my garden, carrot flowers and violas. So first you're going to harvest your violas. My lettuce grow was super overgrown at this point, so I kind of hacked the whole thing off. And then you separate the violas from their stems, so they're easy to like kind of put into the kind of garden bed that we're going to create. Then I made these little carrot flowers. I took a peeler and I peeled the whole carrot. So I had little strips of carrot peels, I guess is what you would call them.
Yeah, ribbons.
Yeah, carrot ribbons, exactly. Yeah. Thank you, Billy. And I rolled those carrot ribbons up so it kind of looked like a little carrot rose. And so I kind of prepped those first. Then I sauteed all of the greens. Every time I make the saute, it looks different, but it's normally like coconut oil, tamari, honey. I've been making this really good homemade gochujang lately.
What else do I put in it? Ridiculous.
I think that's it. Oh, maybe a little rice wine. But I just make some sort of sauteed green base. And then it's like stupidly simple. You just take your flowers, your edible flowers, and you stick them in your garden, and it's like the cutest little freaking dinner you could ever make for each other.
I mean, I think that, first of all, it is rather cute, but the thing that it did for the recipient of it when I first came out and kind of saw it was, you know, it made me slow down. I think a lot of people have a hard time coming in for a landing like we talk about after work. Like, your brain is on all the things that you're trying to do and all the things you're trying to accomplish, and sometimes there's a lot of right angles to the day where you go from waking up to work to gym to, you know, and then all of a sudden it's dinner and your brain is constantly trying to catch up. This was just that little like chuckle and smile that kind of brought me back down to earth. It was a really, really sweet thing to do because it takes that extra bit of, you know, care and attention. And
it shows you I'm thinking of you.
Yeah. And honestly,
and
like,
I want to make you happy with kinda, gardens.
Yeah. And it elevates, I mean, there's some Michelin star vibes on that one. It was pretty nice. It was all dolled up.
I way overcooked the greens, but it was super cute. And I think Billy brings up a good point. In all of these botanically inspired date nights, I think it's super important to try and put your phones away, be present with each other. I think the biggest thing in our relationship, we're both juggling so many things, each of us. We both have multiple things going on, multiple things taking our attention, but trying to find time to like slow down. And Billy always says, like, look in my eyes, like stop looking everywhere else, you know.
Eye contact's really important. It slows you down, it connects you with the person that you love, and especially with these little angry rectangles that are constantly calling for our attention. You know, your phone shouldn't get more of your eye contact than your partner, even though that's not always the It's just, I'd rather look at you than Instagram. But, you know, it's one of those things that I think that taking that time to be a person and to remember that those moments are the moments that you cherish. And
it's easier said than done.
Way easier said than done.
So the second date night is not houseplant themed. It's simply getting outdoors together. Whether it's taking an evening walk, maybe with a cocktail, which is something we've definitely done a couple of times, or like lately, sometimes when we can't connect in the evening, we even like we'll go for a quick 10-minute walk around the block in the middle of the day. But getting outside in nature together without your screens, even if it's itchy and hard because you're going to want to whip your phone out, it's a really nice way to reconnect and reconnect with nature, kind of reconnect with yourself and reconnect with each other. We're super fortunate that the house we're currently living in is on some property and there's a guided path through the woods in our backyard and there's a stream. I am Something that I have realized about myself is that I am obsessed with the sound of trickling water, like stream water, not like faucet dripping water. But it is.
I love a faucet
dripping. I love a dripping faucet. Stream water is so relaxing to me. I listen to recordings of it throughout my workday now because I've realized how much I like it and how relaxing it is because of being outside. And man, like listening to the bird song up here, it's just a really relaxing place. Everything kind of settles down. Everything gets quiet. It's,
yeah. I think, you know, in a pandemic world where a lot of people were working from home, a lot of it was about that partially self-soothing, but partially, you know, just kind of figuring out a way to change gears because everybody's mm-hmm. been in one gear
yeah.
the whole year and then beyond. And also, like, from a health standpoint, it's really good if you're sitting all day to get up and walk.
Oh my God.
Even
yeah.
at Allagash, you know, like there are people at Allagash that when you want to go on a meeting, if you have a meeting at the brewery, you'll go on a walking meeting with them. Or at least that's what we did for years and years. And it's like, it really does. I feel like your brain works better. I feel like you're clearer. I feel like even if you take 10 or 15 minutes, you come back to that next task with a lot more focus.
Totally.
And when you get to do it as like a date night at the end of the day, then that leaves time for creative thought, that leaves time for problem solving, that leaves time for
hand-holding.
Lots of hand-holding. That's very, very true. And honestly, I think it's been really nice to be able to have that. You know, it's such a simple thing for it to be a quote-unquote date, but it's also, it feels very date-like every time we do it because we've made a choice for us. And that is kind of the core of a date, making a choice for the both of you.
Also, there's so many fun things to notice and see together. Like, we went on a walk, you know, this week in the evening, and there was all this new growth because it's yeah. spring right now. Like, there was all this new growth on the trees. There was, you know, all of these beautiful flowers, which was so nice. The other day, like, we were driving up here, and there was a freaking porcupine crossing the street. Like, there's always deer everywhere. There's always little animals to look at. There's always birds to listen to. And yeah, there's just something about being in nature that really just like settles your mind. And I think it does make it easier to connect.
Yeah.
Because you don't have your phone, there's not a TV in the background, there's not a podcast, there's not a million things. And even today too, today I had a rough day, a lot of overwhelming things. And we went for a quick, like probably 7 minute walk outside. I was kind of in my peak anxiety and the walk really helped. I mean, coming back, I felt like a different person at the end of that walk because I felt like Billy and I got to connect. I got to kind of get out of my head and like, you know, see how tall trees are and like remember how little my life matters in the grand scheme of things. And also like, or my how little my problems matter.
Yeah, I was going to say like,
life
matters a whole bunch. Matter. But it is, I think you kind of stumble across something there where it's like, you know, sometimes our problems do feel like our life,
yeah.
you know, like it takes up too much of the view screen and you can't see anything else.
Yeah.
So a little perspective walk in the middle of the day is a good thing to do.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
So planty date night number two, go get outside with nature plants, IRL, go for a walk, get outside, go for, even if you live in a city, like go for a walk around your block, go to a local park, do what
Doesn't
you can
where.
To get in nature.
Dance on your rooftop.
Hang out and, you know, get those little to-go cups, put a nice little cocktail, pull a nice little beer in there, and you're good to go on your date night.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what Yetis are for.
Exactly. so that's planty date night number two. Okay, planty date night number three, the third and final date night. Planty date night number three, bring it inside and have a level two, which we will tell you about, conversation amidst your plants.
Yeah.
So this happens for us in several different areas, whether it's this corner, whether it's in our living room next to our lettuce grow. But Billy and I, over the course of our relationship, have used this key that we've created that has been so helpful for our relationship, our ability to grow, and our ability to connect. And it's level one conversations and level two conversations. So level one conversation is... and if you can do them amidst your plants, that's a great idea. But level one conversation is your normal day-to-day, the conversation you're going to have every day. How was your day? What did you do?
Check-ins.
What do you have on your list of things? Like, what do you have on your schedule for today? When do we get to connect? Blah, blah, blah. Check-ins, logistical, cut and dry, like whatever. Level twos are when you go beyond that, when you dive deeper, when you connect in a much more meaningful way, when you actually get to know each other continuously, like keep continuing to learn things about each other, which is super interesting. And level twos, I feel like, are where that like continued connection happens, right? What do you think about level twos?
Well, the way that we used to talk about it, so we did long distance for what, 4 years, 3 years?
So many years.
Way too many years.
Way too many years.
More years.
New York, Boston.
Yeah, more years long distance than we've got to spend together. But we used to do this thing, and we still do it today, where level twos are where you grow. It's where you check in about hopes and dreams. And the metaphor of being around a bunch of growing plants is really nice because it kind of keeps you present.
And always growing and always blooming and keep blooming, keep growing in your relationship. Like you keep blooming, keep growing in life.
Dork. It's true though. Sorry. It's really true. No, I mean, honestly, it's, I think that I find that the level two is something where we'll actually ask each other for them at a certain point. If we feel like we haven't had a chance to really connect.
Totally.
And it is, it's a big part of any date night is, you know, like, I feel like when you sit down at like a quick dinner, you're like, oh, how was your day? And those are important too. It's important to know where your partner is, but when we get down to the point of like, you know, what are our hopes? What are our dreams?
How do you feel about where you are?
Exactly.
In like, what were your goals you told me about a month ago? Like, how are you feeling about them now? Like, how are you doing? How is your heart?
How's your mind? How's your soul? Like, where, like, and those are the kinds of things that only, you know, a partner is the only person that can really ask you those things. And honestly, it makes a big difference because, you know, that is where I've always said that we take leaps and bounds, right? You're always walking forward. You're always trying to make progress. But level twos are where you really connect and you vault forward into the next stage because you'll uncover some really interesting stuff. You'll find answers to problems that you've been working on for a while that you haven't been able to figure out. It is a really important thing. And when you kind of like ensconce it in the idea of a date night, it takes a lot of the... it infuses it with a lot more fun and happiness because now you're just having a drink around a lot of plants and relaxing, and you can do it with any drink, but you know, there's something about just checking in that's important.
Even just a lemonade.
You can do a lemonade, so it doesn't matter.
Even just a bubbly water.
Bubbly water.
From our most prized possession, the bubbly water. What's it called?
The bubbly water maker.
The bubbly water maker. So for us, questions that kind of bring you from level one to level two are like, how do you feel about, what do you think about, you know, checking in on this thing you shared with me? Like, what are some other good, like, question prompts for level two?
Well, I think a lot of it has to do with active listening. So, you know, if Maria is writing her book, where she is writing her book, I'll ask specifically about
news. Oh. I'm writing a book.
Oh, sorry.
But more to come. More to come on that.
Is that not supposed to say that?
Yeah.
You want to take it again?
No, it's okay. Okay.
So I think active listening is a really important part of all of it, because if you're paying close attention to what your person is telling you, you're going to come up with specific questions. So, you know, if I am taking a class on something, she'll ask me specifically, how did that lesson go? You know, I know that you were working on that project with your team. How has your team been to work with?
Are you feeling about this class?
Yeah. How are you feeling about the class? Do you feel like you're prepped for your midterm? And that will elicit a lot of answers of, you know, like, I really do need to study chapter 8 one more time. And I think that the more that I learn about this thing, and it just goes from there. But specific questions bring about specific and deeper answers. And mm-hmm. that's the key to a level two, is actively listening throughout all the level ones and actively listening all the time, because then you're going to remember certain things and you'll be able to bring them up later. And that's an act of love. You know, paying attention there's a reason they call it paying attention, because you have to offer it. You know, it's important.
Preach.
Right?
How lucky am I that that's my partner?
I feel the same way.
Okay, now that we've gone through our planty date nights, I want the listeners to get to know, or the watchers to get to know, the YouTubers, the plant tubers, the plant watchers, whoever you are.
We don't know the name watching. For it yet, apparently.
Billy's been on the podcast a bunch of times, kind of talking about our experience as in our relationship, but more like our relationship and how it was affected by when I started collecting plants, because I started collecting plants like three years into our relationship when we were living together, and it wasn't smooth sailing. We had some rocky moments. So all of those episodes Billy's been featured in, kind of sharing our story, for if you have partners who are like nervous about your plant collection, they're in the show notes. But Billy, why don't you like kind of clue everyone in?
My experience was like being at the center of a green tornado where there was just like plants everywhere all of a sudden. But no, I'm a pretty traditional, like, love, like, dark wood tones and metal, and I'm a walking stereotype with the things that I like, and
a lumbersexual is what we call
it. But yeah, I mean, honestly, it was it started off as you sharing some things that you were passionate about, and it's really easy to get invested in something that the person that you love is invested in. So I started off as like supporting your new passion.
Mm-hmm.
Then it became overwhelming for our little one bedroom. And all of a sudden I had to put her on a plant pause, or ask her to go on a plant pause, which didn't actually mean a pause. It just meant that the velocity slowed down a little bit. But the best part about it was she knew that I had history in kitchens and that I really loved cooking. And she did something very, very smart, which was she started to bring fresh herbs and a lime tree into the house. And
Limey!
Yeah.
Limey, our bear's lime tree, who has like 40 limes on him
finally,
right now.
Takes
40
years.
Is an exaggeration, but like it's been a really rough couple of years with Limey, and he's finally like actually setting and growing fruit, which we're really excited about.
Yeah, and honestly, I had never had the experience of picking a lime off of a tree and making a cocktail with that lime, and it was the best like drink I had ever tasted, and I was like, oh, this is so cool, and I was hooked. And I became incredibly protective of a fair few plants. Rafi over there, I'm very protective of him. I really love this Monstera because when Maria was on tour, I became plant dad, which was something that I was absolutely terrified about, was positive that she was going to come back to a big old plant graveyard. And thankfully, she gave me a lot of notes and help to kind of keep everything alive. And we've had some success. So now I'm pretty much all in, especially because the podcast has opened up a really wonderful world of people. And more than anything for me, the plants are great, but the people who love plants are, they're set apart. It's really, you guys are awesome. So thank you for supporting the person that I love, and I'm happy to be here. Yes.
So those are our three planty date nights. Highly recommend all three. Do them all, do them frequently.
They're simple, but they're great.
And let us know in the comments which ones you do, which ones you try, which ones you like. Any maybe date nights you feel like we missed, maybe we'll do a part two of this
Absolutely
video.
Absolutely, we'll do
like
a part
it.
Two. Yeah.
But we're so thankful to have made this video in partnership with Allagash Brewing Company. We love Allagash Brewing Company. And hot news, hot tip, Billy works for Allagash.
I do, yeah.
And some of the followers might know that because he has an Allagash Instagram account, and some don't. But Billy's been fortunate enough to work for Allagash for the last many years, for almost the entirety of our relationship.
7 years.
Yeah.
It has been
the
best.
Jinx.
Yeah.
You owe me a beer.
They're an incredible company. Certified B Corporation, which if you don't know is a benefit corporation. It's a higher level of environmental, social, and stakeholder stewardship. It's been really cool to be surrounded by a bunch of very passionate people because...
Nice people.
Very nice people.
Really nice
I mean, family. It's one of those things where every batch of every beer that we make goes through a lot of love and a lot of care, and we would never put something out that we ourselves wouldn't enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, it's been a privilege to be able to work with them because we make things like this where we're getting to support small farms, and we're doing this is our first year-round organic beer, and these little steps are the steps that just matter so much in the grand scheme for somebody who works for a company, because it keeps you super engaged and excited for the next day, for sure.
And talking about privilege, I have to say, like, I'm so lucky to have partnered with Allagash. If you've been listening to the podcast, you know they've been sponsoring for the last 2 months, celebrating the launch of Fineacre, which is their first year-round organic beer. I had no idea that it took so much to make a beer organic. You have to have fully organic everything that goes into the beer, all the crops, all the plants. You have to do specific cleaning with the machinery that you brew the beer with. The farms that grow the grains and everything that you use for the beer like need to be inspected by an organic farmers association like every 3 years or something. Yep. And it's been really interesting, and I feel really lucky. I was not a beer drinker before I started dating Billy. So Billy's a real beer nerd. It's been a really fun 7 years, like kind of just getting, I mean, I've got to learn about beer at the best brewery in the country. So like, I'm pretty lucky. But yeah, it's been really interesting. And I have to say, like, man, Fineacre is so good. So Billy.
Yes.
In beer nerd terms, like, what is Fineacre?
So in beer nerd terms, Fineacre is our first year-round organic beer, and it is a Belgian-inspired golden ale. So you get a really wonderful malt characteristic. It's really bright and effervescent and crisp. 5.5%, so a really good sessionable ABV. Yeah. And honestly, it's one of those beers that fits a lot of different scenarios. I find myself, I'm a situational beer drinker. I pick my beer based on what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. And for walks out in the woods and relaxing
spring
at the end
and
of
summer as it gets hot.
Yeah, relaxing at the end of a long day and just and being around friends. It's at an accessible style. So, yeah. You know, I can enjoy it with pretty much everything, which is great.
And I'm not a beer drinker. Well, I am a beer drinker, but I'm not a beer nerd. I can appreciate a good beer now. Not yet. Well, I'm growing into it.
Well,
but
she's a
plant
nerd.
I would say I can't describe a beer the way Billy can. I know that it's a Belgian inspired golden ale. But like, for those of you who aren't crazy beer drinkers, like, it's just freaking tasty. It's crisp. It's well balanced. There's no like weird. I hate when I drink beer and there's that weird like at the end of it. Billy knows this because I like make weird faces in bars all the time. But yeah, like, it's very even to drink. It's crisp. It's light. It's when it's so cold, like when it's right out of the fridge, like it's so tasty, especially as it's getting warmer. I'm really looking forward to drinking this in the garden this summer. Very much so.
Pairs well with dirty hands and, you know, yeah. Gardens and stuff.
Yeah,
too.
Man. And also just like porch sitting.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Very excited for porch sitting with this. So Fineacre, all the details for where to find it are in the show notes below. Thank you, Allagash, for partnering with Bloomingrow Radio. We appreciate your support. And if you are interested in helping your community and helping yourself, you should definitely consider joining the Allagash Beer Gardening Sweepstakes. It's ending at the end of this week, so click the link below so you don't miss the deadline, because this thing is unbelievable. So first off, you get to donate $2,500 to a local gardening nonprofit of your choice. That's amazing. Think about the impact that's going to have on some sort of nonprofit in your community. Then, on top of that, you get $300 gift certificate to Bloomscape. That's plants delivered right to your door. You get a gift card for Allagash merch. And then you also get a free gardening consultation with me, Maria. Maybe Billy will even make an appearance, but we'll have a Zoom consultation where we talk about your plant collection, what plants work, and maybe based off of that Zoom consultation, you'll kind of cash that Bloomscape gift card in and get some more plants for your collection. So all the details are below to enter the sweepstakes. You should definitely do it. It ends this week, so make sure you enter. Find a Fineacre near you. Follow Billy on Instagram, @Billy. What else?
That's
and
it.
Keep blooming.
And keep growing.